Okay. I'll just put this. Yeah. So, good afternoon, everybody. Once again, pleasure to be with the Kolhapur Academy of Pediatrics. Teaching is something which helps us also learn. So, I enjoy it. And today we are going to discuss on approach to thrombocytopenia in children as a topic. So let's begin with how is it formed. If we look at this cartoon, which is published in journal Blood, it shows you nicely that this is a stem cell. And once it commits to a BFU and CFU megakaryocytic, that is burst forming unit and a colony unit, then it will further differentiate into forming megakaryocytes with early differentiation, an immature megakaryocyte, terminal differentiation will form a mature megakaryocyte. And this mature megakaryocyte then sheds the platelets out of its own cytoplasm. These are the platelets that get shed, which is then known as thrombopoiesis or platelet shedding. So this is how platelets are formed. Now this cartoon I have put here because this will help us to understand some of the inherited disorders of platelets that we will be also dealing with in the latter part of the talk. And this is how a platelet looks in on under electron microscope. And this is the comparison of sizes. If you can see, this is a RBC, this is a WBC, and this is a platelet. So it is much smaller than the white cell and the red cell. And in hemostasis, we all are aware it has a function to form the initial platelet plug, wherein it actually adheres first to the injured endothelial lining and then attracts more platelets to form a platelet plug and then attracts the coagulation factors, which then form a proper hemostatic plug with the fibrin finally making fibrin strands in which a mesh of all these cells is formed. Now we had looked at this physiology of hemostasis even approach to bleeding in the approach to bleeding talk. So some of you will remember that when we injure ourselves, the first response is a vascular response followed by platelet adhesion, aggregation, clot formation with clotting factors coming into play, clot stabilization by factor 13, limitation of clot by anticoagulation, as well as fibrinolysis to re-establish the vascular patency. What we will focus on in today's talk will be mainly those things that affect the platelet adhesion aggregation, and not platelet adhesion aggregation in functional form, but when the platelet numbers are low, these are the two which will also get affected. But we'll not touch much upon functional disorders. Now, platelet activation pathways also we had discussed during the bleeding lecture, where exposed collagen attracts the von Willebrand factor to get activated. And then through the glycoprotein 1B on the platelet, it actually attracts the platelets to adhere to the endothelial lining. And this in turn activates the glycoprotein 2B, 3A, which then attracts more platelets in the presence of all these substances, ADP, collagen, adrenaline, thrombin. Then this causes the aggregation of platelets and this forms a platelet plug and then generates more and more thrombin, which will then cause enhancement of coagulation pathway. This is how it looks in electron microscopy. Once a clot is formed, the platelet is here, and these are the fibrin strands. Now, what is thrombocytopenia? Let's come to the topic of the day. So a platelet count, which is less than 100,000 per cubic millimeter, is considered generally thrombocytopenia. But counts below 1.5 lakhs per cubic millimeter or 150,000 per cubic millimeter may not be low if stable for more than 6 months in an individual. But if they are not stable and they are dropping further, then it is still to be taken as thrombocytopenia. And actually, by proper definition, when the platelet count is below the 2.5th lower percentile of normal platelet count in the population distribution, then it is considered as thrombocytopenia. How do we corroborate whether this count is really true? We have to always look at reduced platelets on smear. If the platelets are good on smear and your count is low, it is a spuriously low count due to problems with the counter. And because counters are all computerized, there is a chance that there could be a something happening with the computerized calculation, which can give you a wrong count, or if there are micro aggregates of platelets in the blood sample that you have sent, then even that will lead to a low platelet count on the counter. And we had discussed last time about how CBC had shown you a smear, a graph wherein citrated blood gave a normal platelet count when EDTA had given a low count. So these are the things which can give spuriously low platelet counts. We should be aware of this so that we can pick up the phone, talk to our pathology lab, and ask them whether have you looked at these aspects and have you corroborated with smear. If you corroborate with smear, you are almost confident to tell the patient that you do not have thrombocytopenia or you have thrombocytopenia. Now, mechanisms of thrombocytopenia, I think all of us through our UG, PG days, we have learned this theoretically, but I just thought we will enumerate them today before we go on to some cases. So if you look at the main reason for thrombocytopenia in children is increased peripheral destruction, the commonest cause being ITP, HUS sometimes, DIC sometimes in the ICU setting. But reduced production is what also we encounter as hematologists, and bone marrow failure is the reason for that. And bone marrow failure in various ways. For example, it may be infiltration by leukemia, by lymphoma, by tumors, by some myelofibrosis, which is causing the space to be reduced for production of cells, or it could be actually an aplastic anemia, or it could be a myelodysplastic syndrome, and so on and so forth. Sequestration of platelets is one very uncommon cause, though known, by congestive splenomegaly, which can lead to thrombocytopenia. And the rarest of all, which we do not see much in pediatric practice, but it is seen commonly in trauma wards or trauma ICUs rather, where hemodilution related, when you give massive fluid therapy or you give whole blood transfusions, it leads to dilutional thrombocytopenia. So reduced production, I already alluded to, aplastic anemia. And commonly we see acquired, which we commonly know by seeing the child if there is no dysmorphism and if there is any features which are suggestive of dysmorphism or thumb anomalies, radial anomalies, then yes, it could be Fanconi's or one of those constitutional hypoplastic anemias. But if there are none of these kind of features, it is unlikely, but it is not ruled out. You have to do a cytogenetic study to rule out. Therefore, acquired has to be mentioned only after we have done the studies to rule out the constitutional anemias. If there are features which are classical, there are some congenital anomalies which are classical, yes, you would consider constitutional. But if you do not find classical features, still you must do a genomic study. So we generally send the clinical exome in all our patients of aplastic anemia to confirm this is not a constitutional and this is an acquired. Today it is available, so we have started doing. For Fanconi specifically, you can just do a chromosomal breakage under stress, and that would be stress cytogenetics, we call it. And that will give you, at least in most of the cases, a confirmation if it is positive. If negative, you cannot rule it out, because if you do lymphocyte-based cytogenetics, you may get negative in those who are mosaics. In those, you have to do skin fibroblast-related cytogenetics, but those are not commonly being done in the city, and therefore it is difficult sometimes for us to achieve that. Okay. Then coming to bone marrow disorders, infiltrative disorders, leukemia, lymphoma, myelofibrosis, I already told you, MDS, and HLH. Do not forget HLH. Familial or infection-associated HLH can lead to thrombocytopenia, and sometimes you may not consider it as significant, but it is a significant condition. It's a significant cause of thrombocytopenia. Where you have both mechanisms, reduced production and increased destruction, immune thrombocytopenic purpura, megaloblastic anemias also can have both, PNH, and severe infections, both acute and chronic, can have both, DIC, where you have peripheral destruction, consumption rather, and because of infection or whatever is the etiology of DIC, you can have a bone marrow suppression and production may be hampered. So both can happen. Increased destruction purely is common with, obviously, first is immune thrombocytopenic purpura. This should read immune, not idiopathic. Hemolytic uremic syndrome. HIV leads to thrombocytopenia through the same mechanism which you have in immune thrombocytopenic purpura. SLE or any other collagen vascular disorder will again have thrombocytopenia due to antibody-mediated destruction. TTP is a peripheral consumption. Localized DIC due to Kasabek-Merritt syndrome also leads to a localized consumption. Purpura after blood transfusions is again because of localized consumption. So these are the causes of increased destruction. What are the clinical implications of thrombocytopenia? Clinically significant spontaneous bleeds occur when platelet counts are below 20,000 per cubic millimeter. However, any thrombocytopenia will pose risk of trauma and surgery and cause bleeds. So you must not leave even a 50,000 count alone if there is going to be a procedure done. Certain medications should not be administered in presence of even milder thrombocytopenia, and therefore we must know the platelet count truly. Diagnosis is simple, straightforward. Sometimes it can be grave and life-threatening. Because in children, most of the times you will have an acute immune thrombocytopenic purpura. But as we have worked in hematology, we know there can be so many grave conditions which come initially with only thrombocytopenia and they end up being a very life-threatening condition. So this I had discussed in the approach to bleeding last time. If bleeding is generalized, ask whether it is platelet type or coagulation type. So in history, these are important aspects, the type of bleeding manifestation. If it is mainly mucosal and skin bleeds, petechiae, bruising, gum bleeds, epistaxis, menorrhagia, then this is more commonly platelet type. And both quantitative and qualitative platelet disorders will have this kind of bleeding. And then, of course, we must, again, in thrombocytopenia, also differentiate whether this seems to be an acquired disorder or a congenital disorder. Again, the same principles apply. If it is recent onset, never had in the past, at a later age of life, in children, maybe at 10 years, 8 years, then it is more likely acquired. But if it has been there since 1 year of age, 2 years of age, then you should worry about a congenital disorder, which may not manifest at birth, but which can manifest at 6 months, at 1 year, at 1.5 years, 2 years, 3 years. So up to 3 to 4 years, if there has been repeated intermittent bleeds chronically, then I would consider a hereditary disorder also. So let's look at this case. This is a typical case which presents to us in our daily practice, day-to-day practice. Healthy 8-year-old girl, born of a non-consanguineous marriage, sudden onset red spots on body for 2 days, gum bleeds and melena for 1 day, no headache, blurring of vision or seizures. So there was nothing to suggest a intracranial bleed. No pallor noticed. That means other cell lines probably were not involved. No lump in abdomen. No swellings on body noticed anywhere. So this was how she looked. I think this picture is familiar. Most of us have seen in some or the other talk. Because I use this picture commonly to depict acute bleeding in a child. And you can see petechiae, bruises. She is otherwise healthy looking. There was no lymphadenopathy, no liver, spleen palpable. And this was confirmed petechiae by slight test. She had a past history of sore throat with moderate fever 2 weeks before this episode. And on examination was well looking, had only these bleeds and no liver, spleen. No other systemic findings. On laboratory investigations, we did a complete blood count, platelet counts. Your phone was ringing. Platelet counts, MPV, immature platelet function, other cytopenias. We looked at all these. In peripheral blood smear, of course, we looked for platelet size and numbers, granularity, and morphology of other cells. SOS, a bone marrow examination was planned for her if required, to look at number of megakaryocytes and its morphology and overall marrow picture in case you are suspecting something other than just a simple thrombocytopenia. So what did we find in her? So in her CBC report, if you see, hemoglobin is 9.3 and MCV is 77. Her RDW is looking quite okay. So she looks like as if she has some iron deficiency preceding, or maybe just because of this bleed, acute bleed, maybe she had a little epistaxis and therefore she's got a little low hemoglobin. White cells were normal. Platelets were 15,000. Now look at the MPV is 7.5, but we cannot comment on this because of the very low platelet count. Do not comment on MPV if the platelet count is very low. It could be erroneous. And when we looked at the peripheral smear, she had large platelets, as you can see. They're larger than normal and they are scanty, hardly any platelets. White cells were looking good, lymphocyte, poly, RBCs, they were looking good. There was little hypochromia, which is suggestive of a low hemoglobin, which could be again acute blood loss. This was her marrow picture. She had increased megakaryocytes and they seemed good normal megakaryocytes ranging from immature to mature. Now, obviously we thought of ITP as a diagnosis. And what does ITP stand for? Earlier we used to call it idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura because the cause was not known. Then it got redesignated as immune thrombocytopenic purpura. Now many authors prefer to call it only immune thrombocytopenia, as purpura is not a necessary finding. There could be just epistaxis, there could be just gum bleeds. So therefore, they do not want to call it purpura, but I think it's not important. It is hair splitting. Immune thrombocytopenia in immune thrombocytopenic purpura, both are okay. So immune thrombocytopenic purpura is the commonest cause for acute onset thrombocytopenia in an otherwise well child. We all know this. And 80% would be acute, and this would be a self-limiting disease with spontaneous resolution within 3 months. 5% may have recurrent acute ITP. Only about 20% or 15 to 20% of children who do not remit within 12 months will be termed as chronic. Now, epidemiology wise, 60 to 150 cases per 1 million children per year are known to occur. And distribution is equal between males, females. Peak incidence is 2 to 6 years, but we see it a little later. 4 to 10 years is more accurately the incidence that we have been observing. It's a benign self-limited disorder, requires minimal or no therapy in majority of cases, no convincing evidence that medical treatment alters the natural history of the disease. Now, by definition, it is immune-mediated destruction with a platelet count below 100,000 per cubic millimeter, with white cells and hemoglobin normal, with no lymphadenopathy or organomegaly in an otherwise healthy child with no lymphadenopathy at all. We have different classifications for ITP. Primary class ITP is when you do not have a known etiology, whereas secondary ITP when you have a known etiology, which are several conditions like Aplas syndrome, Evans syndrome, the common variable immune deficiency, drug-induced infections of various kinds, CMV, HCV, HIV. H. pylori is not common in children, so we do not really test for this now any longer. Lymphoproliferative disorders, SLE and other autoimmune disorders. So all these would form the secondary ITP, but it is still ITP. So what history one must take in patients who come to you like this? So history related to autoimmune disorders, infections, malignancies should always be taken. Joint swellings, pains, bony pains, fever, rashes, recurrent symptomatic thrombocytopenia with complete recovery without specific treatment should prompt suspicion of drug-induced thrombocytopenia. And parents' history, if they are high risk for HIV, should always be taken. So clinically, you must look for skin and mucosal bleeds and petty K and associated signs of vasculitis, organ damage. These will tell you secondary ITP. But if these are absent, that means it is mostly primary ITP. Then you can classify ITP by duration of onset. Newly diagnosed is diagnosis to 3 months. Persistent is 3 to 12 months and chronic is more than 12 months. So when you look at this, you cannot say this is acute ITP when he is newly diagnosed. You can only call it newly diagnosed. Acute ITP is more a retrospective term. So if a patient does not develop any problems after 3 months and you see him after 1 year, 2 years, then you can tell, yes, this was only acute ITP. At the time, you are not sure whether he'll go into persistent, whether you'll go into chronicity. You can also classify ITP by response to medications as responsive or refractory. And refractory term initially was coined on the basis of no response even to splenectomy. But today we really do not splenectomize our ITPs with the availability of rituximab and eltrombopag and romiplostim. There are many other molecules which are now being used for ITP as a routine, and therefore splenectomy has almost become an obsolete procedure. So this would now today be a little difficult to swallow. We could change it to refractory, means it is not responding to various routine medications. You also can classify ITP by severity of symptoms, and this is by the NHS guidelines, where mild is just bruising, petechiae, or minor epistaxis, where there isn't so much epistaxis that the patient becomes anemic or bleeds longer than 20 minutes. Whereas moderate is more severe skin manifestations with larger bruising, epistaxis longer than 20 minutes, significant epistaxis, mucosal bleeds, hematemesis, but no hypotension, and hemoglobin does not fall more than 2 g/cent. Severe is severe epistaxis, mucosal bleeds requiring hospitalization, requiring more than 10 ml per kg of packed red cell transfusion with hemoglobin drop of more than 2 g/cent, hypotension and or intracranial bleed or life-threatening internal bleeds. These are all severe ITP. So is bone marrow examination mandatory? This we have been debating for years, I think. And there are different schools of thought. ASH guidelines, Americans do not believe. They say it should be reserved for patients with atypical features. That means when you're not sure of ITP clinically and on the basis of routine investigations. But British guidelines, like Indian, say perform if steroids. And IAP guidelines still say you perform if steroids are to be given. So most of us would use steroids because IVIG is non-affording. In a non-affording patient is difficult to give. So one would do a bone marrow if one gives steroids. ITP is a diagnosis of exclusion. Antiplatelet antibody testing has poor sensitivity and high interlaboratory variability and therefore is not recommended. Diagnosis should be based on history, family history to rule out familial thrombocytopenia, physical examination, and basic tests that we perform routinely in a thrombocytopenia. Managing the ITP, treat acute ITP only if there is moderate to severe symptomatic patient. Mucosal bleeds, impending ICH, platelet count too low with a potential of internal bleeds, or prior to procedures, as I earlier alluded to, that procedures will cause bleeding, so we must treat them. What to treat with? I think everyone is familiar with intravenous immunoglobulins, but earlier we gave a dose of 2 g per kg body weight total dose, which used to be divided into 1 g per kg per day for 2 days, or 400 milligrams per kg per day for 5 days, or 500 milligrams per kg per day for 4 days. But now the dose has been modified after many studies, and they have come to a conclusion that 0.8 to 1 g per kg body weight, one single dose on the same day, is enough and takes care of ITP. Steroids, again, there are two ways to give, low dose and high dose. High dose we prefer because then it's a very short duration, 4 milligram per kg per day in divided doses, 4 days. Low doses, 2 milligram per kg per day, routine doses in divided doses for 2 weeks, followed by tapering over 1 to 2 weeks. Anti-D is a third drug which is also recommended in primary management or first line management, but this can be given only in those who are Rh positive and non-splenectomized, and those who have a hemoglobin about 10 g/cent, because it can cause a drop of hemoglobin. So you do not want to give if already patient is slightly anemic. In emergency treatment, you can use platelet transfusion, but then you have to give very high volume, 2 to 3 fold or even up to 4 fold usual volume. Along with, you can use steroids and methylprednisolone 30 milligrams per kg per day for 3 days, or IV immunoglobulins. In menorrhagia and oral bleeds, you can use antifibrinolytic agents, but if hematuria is present, these are contraindicated. One can initiate the low estrogen oral contraceptive pills in girls who are adolescents and have menorrhagia in consultation with a gynecologist. Then, are there some factors which will tell you this child will go into chronic ITP? So there are some predisposing factors, like older age at presentation, less severe thrombocytopenia at presentation, insidious onset where it is not a crash. You know, one day one patient comes to you and has petechiae and ecchymosis, bleeding profusely in the skin, and has a platelet count of 5,000 or 10,000. It would be like, I had petechiae, but the platelet count was 30,000, 40,000, things like that. Lack of preceding infection and or vaccination. So these are the things which will tell you this is not an acute onset ITP, this is a chronic ITP. So let's look at this child. She came, 4.5-year-old girl, came with PETK in September. On examination, she had no pallor, lymph nodes, mucosal bleeds or liver spleen. Was diagnosed a case of ITP. Platelets were 15,000. Otherwise, CBC was normal. Retic was normal. Peripheral smear showed large platelets. Bone marrow showed adequate megakaryocytes. And bone marrow biopsy was normal. She was started in September of 17 with prednisolone high dose. Platelets increased to 86,000. Got admitted again in November and had a platelet count of again 17,000 with bleeding epistaxis. So we again put her on steroids for 2 weeks and tapered over 2 weeks, low dose steroids. Then in December, again, 1 month later, she received third dose of course of steroids because platelets had dropped to 1,000. And she came at that time to our center after receiving steroids and the platelet count had risen to 56,000. But on 26 December, again on follow-up, she had a 12,000 platelet count. So at this time, we gave her intravenous immunoglobulins. This time, we gave her a little higher dose though. Platelet counts increased maximum to 94,000. Platelet counts again dropped in January to 10,000. She was given IV NTD. It increased only to 35,000. Again in February, so every month she was dropping. It dropped to 12,000. Then we gave her IVIG again, just a small dose, booster dose of 400 milligrams per kg. And we started her on rituximab, but in a lower dose of 100 milligrams and planned to give her 4 doses of IV rituximab. She received a second dose of rituximab on 6/3 on platelet count of 26,000. Her HIV, HBsAg, HCV were non-reactive because now she was almost going into the chronic phase. So we did all the workup. Immunoglobulin levels were normal. Before giving IVIG, this was done and ANA was negative. This is how she behaved with rituximab, not improving at all. And then we put her on pulse dexa for 4 days in March. And then she improved very well. In April, she had a platelet count of 3 lakhs. But if you see, again, she dropped to 28,000. If you can see here, we started her on, the slide changed. Yeah, started her on dapsone and prednisolone, both. Then if you see this slide, again, in May, she was on dapsone with pulse dexa, not maintaining good count, came up here in July of 18. 1 minute, I have to change this. Yeah. And in August, she had 49,000 count. In September 18, she had 41,000. With dapsone alone, now she was being maintained and she was okay with 1,84,000, but again dropped to 37,000. So there was waxing waning. But since she was not bleeding and she was at a safe count, about 20,000, 30,000, we left her alone. And now today she is actually off treatment and she's maintaining about 50 to 60,000 counts. So she is a chronic ITP. Now, all these tests need to be done in every chronic ITP patient because these patients will probably not be a acute ITP and therefore you need to look at them as chronic ITP and do it. So we did all these tests earlier only. Beyond 1 to 1.5 year after presentation, maybe we should look at even other conditions like MDS. So do a cytogenetics and FISH for MDS, thyroid profile and antibodies, and PCR for various viruses. So if she still has low counts, we might consider doing these tests also on her. So how does one manage chronic ITP? The goals of therapy in chronic ITP, there are two: rescue therapy and maintenance therapy. So the goal of rescue therapy is to have a rapid platelet response with a short-term safety. Whereas in maintenance therapy, you have to have a durable platelet response, long-term safety and tolerability and patient convenience, because these will matter in compliance. The desired time to response in rescue therapy when acutely you want to raise the platelet count should be hours to days. whereas here it can be days to weeks. Standard treatment options for rescue therapy are corticosteroids, IVIG, and anti-D. And splenectomy used to be the one where we used to give in maintenance therapy if they do not respond to the rescue therapy. But today we use other medications. So what do we recommend as initial treatment? Children with no bleeding, mild bleeding should be managed with only observation regardless of platelet count. And initial pharmacologic management for patients who need treatment, you may use IVIG single dose, 0.8 to 1 gram, short course of steroids. IVIG may be used if a more rapid increase is desired because it gives a response within 48 to 72 hours, whereas steroids may take 4 to 7 days. Anti-D is not advised in those who have a low hemoglobin or with evidence of autoimmune hemolysis. Otherwise, you may use a single dose of anti-D in those who are Rh positive non-splenectomized children requiring treatment. So this is what we already alluded to, but I'm just showing you these ASH guidelines. Now, in second-line treatments for pediatric ITP, rituximab can be considered for children or adolescents who have ongoing bleeding despite these conventional treatments. It has been considered as an alternative to splenectomy in children and adolescents with chronic ITP or in patients who do not respond favorably to splenectomy. High-dose dexamethasone, pulse dexamethasone can be used again in those who have bleeding despite the conventional treatment or as an alternative to splenectomy. So these are the various newer things that we are doing, as well as there are now newer agents, that is TPOA, thrombopoietin agonist. Thrombopoietin receptor agonist L-thrombobag is the one which we have used more, since last 3 to 4 years, whereas romiprostim has been approved only recently. It is recently approved. I've written here not approved, but it is recently approved even in children, but not for ITP. It is approved for other thrombocytopenias. So L-thrombobag is not recommended for use in newly diagnosed or as rescue therapy, as effect takes about 2 weeks. The response rates are very good, but effect wanes off once you stop. It is useful in combination with steroids in chronic ITP who do not respond to first-line drugs. But it has many adverse effects. As you can see here, it can lead to thrombosis. Transaminitis is very common. And long-term, it is known to cause myelofibrosis in the marrow. Now, romiprostim has also a very good efficacy. It is a subcutaneous drug to be given weekly initially, then to once in a fortnight, and then once a month. But it has not been recommended as yet for ITP, whereas this has been recommended for even ITP. But these drugs should not be used very loosely because one has to monitor them carefully. The doses have to be tailored and titrated based on the platelet counts. So in children below 6 years, we start with 25 milligrams per kg per day. And in above 6 years, we start with 50 and we can go up to 75. But we have to taper it down by 25 milligrams if the platelet counts start rising up. And above 4 lakhs platelets, one should stop L-thrombobag. Now, other alternative agents which have been used for years, dapsone, danazol, vincristine, colchicin, vitamin C, hydroxychloroquine, cyclosporine, mycophenolate, sirolimus, cyclophosphamide, azathioprine. These are all variably tried in various patients and sometimes can work in a given patient, so one can try them. So what is an important advice to a patient with ITP? No contact sports. Avoid intramuscular injections. No NSAIDs such as ibuprofen. This I think I had also alluded to in my approach to bleeding talk, because this was important to be a take-home message for everyone. So I don't think I need to repeat it. All of you are aware of it. We'll go to another case. This was a four-month-old boy born of a non-consanguineous marriage, referred from Nagpur for thrombocytopenia. History dated back 4 months. So at 2 years, he started problems. Bruises incidentally noticed by a pediatrician in Nagpur. Investigations were done in Nagpur. CBC showed hemoglobin of 9.7, total count of 6,200 and a platelet count of 28,000. So it wasn't severe thrombocytopenia, but he was having bruises. So does not really require any treatment. Requires good monitoring, good follow-up and investigations SOS, apart from the CBC. They were on peripheral smear. They had not recorded a giant platelets. MPV was 7.9, which was again low, but then this is because so we were at this patient who had a low platelet count and was not low enough to require treatment. But so what was done at Nagpur, we will see. Bone marrow was done and it showed good megakaryocytes. So they suggested a diagnosis of ITP. And the treatment history at Nagpur was, he was given steroids. I mean, as pediatricians, you can refrain from treating a patient who's having only skin bleeds and really not having mucosal bleeds and a platelet count is good, well about 20,000. This could have been left alone, but nevertheless, he was started on steroids. Platelets improved to 46,000 in a month's time. And then steroids were tapered and platelets started dropping to 6,000. Then on 25th July, that is about a week after he had improved, when he dropped platelets, they transfused platelets and also gave intravenous immunoglobulin at 1 gram per kg. They gave methylprednisone at 30 milligram per kg and then only for one day. Now, this is again something which need not have been done. Either you give this and wait or you give this for 3 days and wait. Okay. Then on 2nd August, platelet counts were good. So they were quite happy that IVIG had worked probably and whatever had been done was working. Now, whether platelets worked, whether IVIG worked or whether methylprednisolone worked, we cannot say. Now here, after 5 weeks, his platelets again dropped to 8,000. Again, they gave him methylprednisolone for 3 days. Platelets again rose to 56,000. Again in September, platelets were 96,000. So they were happy. But platelets fluctuated between 4,000 and 15,000 in first week of October. So about a month after the platelet was recorded 96,000, he again dropped. And once he again dropped, they decided to refer the patient to us on 12th October. So there was nothing otherwise significant in past history. Birth development was normal, except there was a 2.5 month spontaneous abortion in the mother. Now, when we investigated at our center, hemoglobin was fairly good. White cells were okay. Platelet count was 7,000. MPV was not recorded. So we decided to keep a diagnosis of persistent ITP because there was so much response to various medications that he had received. But at the back of the mind, we kept a ruling out of inherited thrombocytopenia as one of our differentials. When we transfused him platelets, there was no improvement. So obviously we thought this is ITP and not inherited thrombocytopenia. We gave IVIG and he responded and became 75,000 in 3 days. Meanwhile, bone marrow was reviewed. But what did we find in the bone marrow? There were dysplastic megakaryocytes. Marrow was otherwise cellular, but the megakaryocytes were small and monolobated. And there we thought, now we have to rule out inherited platelet disorder. And other tests were done which were negative. And this was the PS of the patient. ITP patient PS, you see large platelet. And this is this patient, AS. You see very small platelets. Now, very small platelets can happen in two or three conditions only, inherited conditions. And one of them is Viscott-Ehlrich. So we thought we should rule out. And you see these dysplastic megakaryocyte. This is not a normal megakaryocyte with a monolobated cell. Whereas in an ITP, you will see this kind of picture. So this is what the CBC looked like with platelet count of only 9,000. And this is after giving him all the treatment that we gave him, transfused platelets and IVIG, he became 42,000. So there was some improvement. But when we got the report from MedGenome for genetic studies, you can see he turned out to be a Viscott-Ehlrich syndrome, X-linked recessive. And this is the final diagnosis. So it can be very, difficult sometimes. And one may not consider these diagnoses of inherited disorders because they sometimes respond to some treatments. But one must look at it in a holistic manner. This child presented at 2 years, is a male child. Platelet MPV is low. His platelets are small on smear. His bone marrow is not showing good normal megakaryocytes. These things should prompt us to look at beyond the ITP and do genetic studies. And we did his HLA with his parents because he had no siblings, but they did not match. They were mismatched loci, 7 by 10, 5 by 10 with mother, 7 by 10 with father. So we could not consider transplant. Then we go to another case. This is a 3.5-year-old boy, first by birth order, born of a non-consanguineous marriage. Birth and development was normal. Was seen by a pediatrician for pneumonia at 4 months of age with no documented CBC at that time. At 3 years of age, on 8th October 2018, he was admitted at Surat. Blood counts were hemoglobin 3.9 grams, 4,100 total count, platelet counts 24,000. So all three cell lines were affected. So a bone marrow aspiration was done at Surat. He was told to have either malignancy or aplastic anemia. I don't know why they couldn't tell them for sure. He was given platelets and packed red cells. And then he was brought to Mumbai to a medical college on 4th December. And here again, they repeated the bone marrow and there was no evidence of leukemia or MDS. He was given supportive care again. Family history, there were similar complaints in the father in childhood. But according to the parents, it resolved. Details were not known what exactly was happening to him. One female sibling was apparently unaffected. Patient was referred to us on 28th December as a case of aplastic anemia to transplant. So we looked at him. He had vitals which were mildly deranged because of anemia. And he was normal in anthropometry, general examination. There was no dysmorphism. Tonsils were present. So immunodeficiency related workup was not immediately mandated. There was PTK. No lymphadenopathy and systemically no liver spleen. Now, when we looked at his CBC at our center, he was 5.1 gram hemoglobin with a 87 MCV, which is on the higher side, with a RDW, which is only 12.1. And white cells, you see lymphocytosis, significant lymphocytosis, hardly any neutrophils seen in the patient. So this is ANC was very low, neutropenia with hemoglobin low with RBC count low with macrocytic type of picture with RDW normal, as you can see here. And see the platelets, just 2000. So he was severely pancytopenic with a classical bone marrow failure like phenomena because of macrocytic and lymphocytosis. So corrected retic was 0.3%, which corroborated with bone marrow failure. Coombs test was negative. Triple H was negative. Hemolytic workup was negative, which was not mandated actually. Bone marrow aspiration study showed aplastic anemia. And chromosomal breakage analysis was negative to rule out Fanconi, but we still don't stop at that. As I told you, we did the genomic studies. Vitamin B12 was normal. And you see the genomic studies showed MPL gene defect, homozygous congenital amegakaryocytic thrombocytopenia, which is autosomal recessive, which is known to manifest initially with thrombocytopenia, but can soon have bone marrow failure, which was seen in this child. So again, one must not forget that patients who come to you like aplastic anemia need not be aplastic anemia, but is a platelet disorder. So familial platelet disorders, which we thought earlier were very uncommon, are not as uncommon today because we are making diagnosis because we have the facilities to diagnose. There's a rare group of hereditary platelet disorders with or without low platelets and with or without platelet functional abnormalities. There's a large heterogeneity in terms of molecular genetic defects. So sometimes you may not be able to pinpoint, but one must try. More than 50% of patients remain partially characterized and without a molecular diagnosis, which is a fact, but at least we must try. So what we saw was a congenital amegakaryocytic thrombocytopenia. And as I showed you earlier, defective megakaryocytic differentiation, that is the stage at which this occurs. There are various other conditions which occur also under this classification. But this MPL gene defect, which you saw in this patient, autosomal recessive inheritance, evolves into bone marrow failure in infancy. This is a TAR, thrombocytopenia with absent radius. Typically, the thrombocytopenia resolves by 1 year of age, but you need surgical correction of the arms, of the bones. Then you have defective megakaryocytic maturation, where you have this familial platelet disorder with predisposition to AML. We had one such case diagnosed at our center. That's why I put this. And we had anchor D26 related thrombocytopenia. Now, these were unknown to us 2-3 years ago because we used to not have clinical exome available. But today, because it's available, we are able to make diagnosis. So you can see this one, RUNX1 gene defect, heterozygous in origin, autosomal dominant, so familial platelet disorder with associated myeloid malignancy, FPD AML syndrome. This child we lost before we could transplant him because he was already having transformed into AML. He was sick. Then this is another one, anchor D26. This also is a non-syndromic thrombocytopenia, autosomal dominant, heterozygous. So these are conditions which may not be picked up if we just consider everybody to be ITP when it is not so. Then you can have many other conditions due to defective proplatelet formation and or platelet release, where MYH9 related disease is a autosomal dominant condition where you have many other defects like cataracts, auditory problems, nephropathy, etc. And in this you also have the Viscott-Aldrich and the X-linked thrombocytopenia, which is again common. So let us look at the congenital thrombocytopenia based on inheritance pattern. So you have autosomal dominant many conditions. As you saw, autosomal dominant familial platelet disorder, acute myeloid leukemia, which we had one of the cases. And then you have autosomal recessive, we saw this one. And then you have X-linked, we saw the Viscott-Aldrich. So all three kinds we actually encountered. Now by platelet size, you should remember that there are only two conditions, X-linked thrombocytopenia and Viscott-Aldrich, which has an MPV below 7, or they are small platelet syndrome. Therefore, if you see small platelets on peripheral smear, it is not ITP, it is one of these. If you see large platelets, it can be ITP or it can be any of these. There are multiple again. And normal platelets are these conditions. So these are all available in books and you need not really remember them. But keep these charts if you are dealing with these patients. How does one manage? Management is same, supportive care with packed cells and platelets for hemoglobin and improving the platelets. If in this child, HLA did not match with sibling and mother. So again, no matched unrelated donor was available from population registry. So we are just awaiting haploidentical HSCT if the parents agree. If they don't agree, we will not do and we'll just give him supportive care. Thrombocytopenia is also known in infections, which interest pediatricians much more, but I thought I will go into more of hematological conditions and just allude to this in one slide. So we all know the infectious mononucleosis, classically EBV, can lead to thrombocytopenia, which can go on for months to years sometimes and can baffle us, especially if a patient is immunodeficient. If he is immunocompetent, he will clear it out maybe within 2 to 3 months. HIV, we have seen ITP-like phenomena in HIV very commonly in our setup at Sion Hospital. And we have treated them like ITP, even with low CD4 counts, they do well with steroids or with IVIG. Leptospirosis, dengue, malaria, I think you all have more experience managing the thrombocytopenia than I would have. Only a word of caution for dengue. In dengue, it is not just platelets which cause bleeding, low platelets, but it is the coagulopathy which adds to the bleeding. And when you give platelet transfusion, it can worsen the patient because consumptive coagulopathy happens. So do not give platelets indiscriminately in dengue. Only give if the platelets are below 20,000 and patient is bleeding actively and you have ruled out coagulopathy by doing a prothrombin time, partial thromboplastin time, thrombin time, fibrinogen and D-dimers. Malaria, we all know thrombocytopenia is a known factor and we have been treating patients just symptomatically. Very rarely in severe malaria, platelet transfusions are required. In CMV, again, post-transplant, we have seen a lot of CMV with thrombocytopenia and here you need to treat them aggressively for CMV infection. And if platelets are low, again, platelet transfusions may be given. Rubella measles, I have not really encountered much of thrombocytopenia, which is requiring treatment. Gram-negative bacteremia or sepsis with DIC can lead to thrombocytopenia and various other infections. torches, of course, we all are aware. So you can have these patients. Now, this was a dengue patient who had this rash. This was a leptospirosis. So you can have these patients coming with rashes which are not petechiae, but they at least tell us what is the diagnosis. And according to the diagnosis, you would decide whether how to treat the thrombocytopenia. So how one approaches thrombocytopenia? Do the peripheral blood smear. If there is platelet clumping, it is artifactual thrombocytopenia, as I told you. If there is low platelets on the smear, then it is true thrombocytopenia. And then you look at the platelet size. If they are giant platelets with WBC inclusions, then think of hereditary thrombocytopenia. Because as I told you, giant platelets, there is a long list of hereditary thrombocytopenia. If there are other type of cells, schistocytes, TTP, HUS, blasts, then it's bone marrow disorder, microspherocytes, Ewan syndrome, lymphocytosis, atypical lymphocytes, you think of, again, leukemia and infections. But if it is isolated, true thrombocytopenia, ITP is one of the commonest ones. Secondary ITP, drug-induced ITP, and secondary ITP should be considered strongly. So depending on what is the kind of finding you have, you will assess the patient further and treat. So this is in short about thrombocytopenia approach. Now, just to end, I would give you two slides of take-home messages for ITP, newly diagnosed ITP, persistent ITP, chronic ITP. This is how you will classify ITP to begin with. Managing newly diagnosed should be observation if no significant bleed and platelet counts are well above 20,000. Otherwise, rescue treatment initially followed by maintenance treatment if persistent. Additional tests should be done in chronic ITP like bone marrow aspiration, biopsy, immunoglobulins, CMV and other viral PCRs, triple H, ANA, Coombs test, cytogenetics and FISH for MDS. Management first line should be steroids, IVIG, IV anti-D. Second line, rituximab, L-thrombopag, other immunosuppressives. Splenectomy, a no-no from my side. For inherited platelet disorders, my take-home messages would be they are often undiagnosed throughout life, especially milder forms, complete blood count and platelets on smear, complete bleeding profile if necessary, aggregation tests and flow cytometry to rule out the platelet functional disorders which are also known to have thrombocytopenia, and genetic studies in all suspected patients who do not fit into the classical ITP and or other common disorders is a very important message I want to give to everybody. I think that's my last slide. Thank you. And if there are any questions and time for questions, I do not mind taking a couple of questions. I will stop sharing. So then,
there is one question, ma'am. What is the treatment option for newly diagnosed severe drug-induced thrombocytopenia?
So you withdraw the drug. First of all, stop that drug. And if there is significant thrombocytopenia, it's more likely immune. So steroids can work or IVIG, either of the two. So there is another question of role of IPF test.
Yes.
So IPF, again, is not as useful in diagnosing conditions, but it helps to know in dengue especially whether patient is recovering so that you do not unnecessarily worry about and you can counsel the parents. I had shown one slide in my approach to bleeding, I believe, in which I showed you all that when IPF starts dropping, that is the time platelets start rising in dengue. But IPF is like MPV. It's a surrogate for MPV. If large platelets are generally younger platelets. And when you have younger platelets, you will have a higher IPF. But IPF is not very well standardized for diagnosis of all these conditions where we have large platelets, especially inherited. Inherited will not show you probably a high IPF because the platelets inherently are large. So if you have large platelets and a higher side IPF, think of ITP. Or, secondary ITP or primary ITP or an infection induced like dengue. Okay.
Yeah, ma'am. Ma'am, I want to ask a question. Like, ma'am, receiving IG in ITP patient, Is it important to send immunoglobulin level every time?
No.
Is it important to send?
No. First time in when you are doing in acute onset ITP, giving IVIG, you don't have to do immunoglobulins. You can wait for 6 weeks to 3 months. And then if he becomes chronic and you now want to rule out CVID, then you do the immunoglobulins before giving either steroids or IVIG. But not necessarily upfront. Many people want to do upfront, but it costs money. And since I have worked always in public sector, I'm always very highly conscious about money being spent unnecessarily. So this is my advice. But if you do it, it is not harmful to the patient, but it is not adding value and you're spending money. Because if he is an acute ITP tomorrow, he'll be fine. You've unnecessarily spent that much additional money. Yeah.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. I enjoyed talking to you all.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. If anybody is having any question, you can ask. Otherwise, you can conclude. Anybody is having any query?
Hello.
Yes. Yes. Can continue.
Yeah, Makaran.
Hello, madam.
Yeah.
First of all, thank you for such a lucid presentation. And the question is very simple. Actually, in a practical office practice, which drug is the first choice, either methylprednisolone or IVIG when a child present with the acute ITP?
So if my patient is affording, I will prefer IVIG because methylprednisolone can cause hyperglycemia acutely. It can cause hypertension. So I don't want to take any chances. IVIG will be my first choice if my patient is affording. If my patient is not affording, I might give methylpredni or even just 4 mg oral steroids.
Okay. So question is only of affordability.
Yes.
Okay. So usually we prefer methylprednisolone because as we work in a low socioeconomic status and it works basically.
It works. You have used it at SINE and you know it. It works.
Yes. Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Welcome. Any other?
No more question.
Okay. Great.
Okay.
Then
okay,
we can
okay,
leave
okay,
the
okay.
session.
Thank
yeah?
you.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you very much, madam. As usual, it was really nice, authentic, though exhaustive, but very, very useful practical points we got from all the slides, and really worth recording and sharing this all slides. We are recording and sending to everyone, so everybody will. So thank you very much again, and we hope that this series we will continue longer time, and you can select more and more practical topics, and everybody will be enlightened with this recent advances and practical knowledge.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Shishir. Thank you, Prasanna. Thank you, Preeti.
Thank you, KAP.
Yeah.